Right. Well, it's a good evening from the studios of Brisbane Radio FM 88 Australia, broadcasting on the 88.0 band in Brisbane, and live through the website, or you can download the app, or alternatively, you can, what's going on here?
We're having fun already.
No, it's the, you won't believe it. It's,
I will.
Facebook have just come up to say they've made changes as of June the 10th. You can stream to your own profile or other platforms. Right, so without further ado, if you, I'd like to introduce Andrena, who can then bring on board our guest from New Zealand.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Hello, everybody, and welcome wherever you are in the world. And today, it's my great pleasure to have Helen Dew on the Helen Dew as a guest on the show today. Helen is on the South Island of New Zealand, and she's
North Island.
Oh, sorry. You were on the South Island at one time, weren't you?
No.
I got my geography wrong then. Anyway, it's lovely to have you on the show. And I watched a video a little while ago, watching you in your garden and how you help community and all your vegetables. It was like a mini Findhorn, just absolutely amazing to see how you transformed a piece of derelict land, if you like, to amazing property and your cabbages. I've just thought, wow, what an amazing lady and what an inspiration you are. So without further ado, welcome, Helen. It's lovely to have you on our show.
Well, thank you, Andrena, and it's a great pleasure to be invited to appear on your show. So I hope you'll find it interesting as we go
I know
through.
I will. So can we start at the very beginning, where you were born and all the steps that have led you to doing all the things that you've done now? Because I know you're an avid gardener and in growing food and helping community. I know you've written, I've seen you talking to the children, reading stories, you've done poems. So you've got quite a lot in your toolbox, if you like. So let's start at the very beginning.
Well, to begin, I was born in the South Island, actually. My family was, my father and mother were holidaying at the top of the South Island in Picton. I was born there. So, they actually lived in Wellington. And they moved up to the Wairarapa when I was 8. And I've been here ever since, in this lovely little village of Carterton. And I just love being part of the community here. And my husband and I raised 4 children, and very proud of them, and we've got lots of grandchildren and great-grandchildren. My husband passed away in 2014, and so I've been on my own since then. We had a big property, well, large-ish by some standards. It was a quarter acre, and it was intensively gardened. In a 4-bedroom house, and in 2018 I had a wee stroke, and so I wasn't able to maintain that property, so I moved to a smaller place and set about setting up a garden here. So it's only about a third the size, 400 square meters, and so I've set it up as a teaching garden, and I run workshops here on teaching people how to garden. So I've always had my fingers in the soil.
That's fantastic. Were your parents avid gardeners?
Oh, Dad planted a spring crop, I suppose. But we moved around a lot, you see, because my dad was a farm labourer, and so we moved around 10 times in 10 years, and so it wasn't easy to keep a garden going in any one place. But of course, in those days, lots of people did have gardens. You know, 60 years ago, it was normal. You grew food in the backyard.
Mm. That's right.
And it's like
in
people
in World War II, wasn't it? Hey, World War II, everybody brought out the community gardens, didn't they?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. And of course, I like to know where my food comes from too. So I'm not keen on sprayed food and artificial fertilizers and all that sort of stuff. So, that's another reason for me doing it. But I think gardening and producing some of your own food, at least some of it, is something we can all do to help build resilient communities, to help our own resilience and build resilient communities. Because I think localization is becoming much more understood and desired. It helps to cut down food miles generally cut our emissions because I'm very concerned about climate change. I think, that by far the most serious issue that humanity has to deal with. And so growing some of our own food is something that we can all contribute in that way. And, of course, not everybody has the ability, for one reason or another, to grow their own. And so there's various other options that, you know, we can collaborate with neighbours and swapping, perhaps baking a cake for some sorbet over the neighbour's fence and things like that. And then there's local farmers' markets. And so I'm a member of our local farmers' market, and we're on holiday at the moment for our winter season, but we'll start again in spring. And I harvest a bit from my own garden. And of course, one of the things I love about the farmers' market is the social aspect of it. You meet all sorts of people there, and from all walks of life, and so that's I've made some very good friends through the farmers' market, and that's something I really value. Just going back to the workshops that I run on gardening, I have a series of growing fruit and vegetables, making compost, and pruning your fruit trees, because I've got an orchard, and seed saving, and I grow orchids too, and so I teach a little bit about orchid care. So I actually, you know, I've injured my back recently, and so I'm not able to get out in the garden at the moment, I plan to do a workshop on pruning. Well, the participants arrived, and one came with a whole range of prunings from her backyard, and we lay a big sheet out in the lounge, and we pruned the various varieties that she'd brought, and it worked. People learned something, and they went out and observed my orchard and to see what I'd already done. I'd already pruned some things before I had my injured my back, and then there was some still to be pruned, so it was pretty obvious the difference. And so, you know, they were able to make observations that way as well. So,
can we go back? Like, I know when you had your younger children, and I know you had there was a time when you had a very low, or got very depressed at one point.
Yeah.
And you went, and I know you went through trauma. So you went through lots of trauma. So what was the thing that got you through that? Was it the garden?
Well, you see, as a young mum, I really struggled with dealing with all the busyness of raising four children, all quite close in age and so forth. But I suffered with postnatal depression, and that went full-blown into a full-scale nervous breakdown. And I had to go into hospitalised care, and that was pretty tough. It was tough for me, but it was also tough for my kids and for my husband. He was marvellous, but that took quite a while for me to recover from. And I had, had help along the way with counselling and medication and so on. And gradually, I got through it. But I wouldn't have done it without the help of my community, my family, medication, all those things combined. Mm. Yeah, it was a tough time.
Mm. Yeah, I bet. So where did you, like with your garden, can we show the pictures of the derelict, how you started?
I have to go to the video, wouldn't I?
You put some photos in our group chat.
Yeah, we posted some photos.
Did you really? Oh, I haven't seen those. Oh, okay. Well, you guys carry on talking and I'll go look for them.
Okay, good.
Yeah, because I know you've got various Facebook groups as well, haven't you?
Oh, yes, I belong to quite a few different organisations. The principal one is Living Economies. That's an educational trust, and our main focus is on the money system and alternatives to, ordinary money. And so we, at one time, for many years actually, I belonged to a local exchange trading system, commonly called green dollars here in New Zealand, and I think it was a very successful for quite a long period. But I recently resigned from that because at the age of 86, I need to simplify my life. And so that was one thing that I didn't need to continue with. But Living Economies also promotes a variety of other things that I think provide opportunities for people to explore other ways of us exchanging goods and services. Yeah, one of the most interesting ones we have is our savings pools. It's a savings and loan system that is interest free. Now. Well, where to begin with that story? I met a woman called Margaret Kennedy. She was and her husband were touring New Zealand in 2002, I think it was, and Margaret brought her book called Interest and Inflation Free Money, and it certainly opened my eyes. It helped me to focus on what I want to do with the rest of my life, is to look at that whole business of interest. And so she invited me to a conference in Germany the following year. In 2003, I went there to participate as a co-presenter with a colleague. And to learn from the international presenters there, and it was fascinating. And there I met a woman called Eva Stenius, and she was from Sweden. And we got on like sisters. And so she told us about the Swedish JAK Bank, which is Swedish acronym for land, labor, and capital. And that bank was very successful in helping people avoid interest payments on their loans. When I came back to New Zealand, we started up after quite a long interval, we started up the savings pool interest-free system here. Now that wasn't set up as a bank as it had been in Sweden, but it's kind of small cells of family or friends who lend to one another interest-free. And we've helped quite a few people through that. So it's something that I think is quite special. And there's information about that on our Living Economies website about how that works. Anyway.
Right. Did you find the pictures, Jeff? You're still looking.
Never mind.
Anyway.
Oh, I'm starting to get up. 8%.
Oh, really?
10%.
Okay.
Are we getting close to time?
No. He was talking about the pictures.
All right.
So carry on, because I know you said you were into currency. You know, you did a lot to do with the currency.
Well, obviously. You see, that was in 2003. I went to that conference, and then I went to New York to a similar conference where there were several different presenters, and so there I learned about time banking, and that's where people do things for one another, not counting in money but counting in hours, and so the time banking. Then I had a colleague with me, Margaret Jeffreys, and she helped to establish the first time bank in New Zealand, in the South Island, just out of Christchurch there, and that was very successful. And time banking has taken off in various centres throughout New Zealand, some with more success than others, but that's a great success story from that visit too. And we met the initiator and all that sort of thing, and it was a fantastic experience. So I still have contact with some of those people too, and I think I'm a born networker, and so I love to link people up, and it's. Oh, there's my garden. That's pruning some of the tree that is in the background there. It had gotten rather too big. It was hanging over the house. So, yeah. And here's the garden, productive. And, yeah. So, I haven't got any lawn on my property. It's 400 square metres. And as you can see, there's no lawn. And so I've used arborist mulch as a covering right through the orchard and right through the whole property. Now I prepared the orchard. Oh, look at that having party! I prepared the orchard by having a wonderful labourer to dig the holes for the trees, and then I didn't disturb the rest of it. I just spread. I got a bale of seaweed, and I had my own compost that I'd been making for ages, and so I had lots of that. I had coffee grounds and leaf mould, and I spread a bit of a bit of lime as well, because the pH was a bit low, and so I spread all that out, and then I got thick wads of newspaper and put that on top. And then on top of that, I put about 4 inches of arborist mulch, which is sort of freshly chipped branches and leaves that settles down there and makes it quite firm to walk on. And but it also has the advantage of encouraging the growth of fungi. Now there's a symbiotic relationship between the trees and the fungi. And so the leaves on the trees bring down the energy from the sun and feed that down to the roots, and then the fungi is attached to the roots, and the roots, the fungi can travel far and wide, far much further than the network of tree roots, and so they bring goodness of all kinds back to the tree, and so it's beneficial both ways. So yeah, and when the orchard was young and the trees weren't very big, because that picture is 2018 when I first started, and of course you know everything's got bigger now. But I used to plant my vegetables in amongst there as well, and they did really well. Yeah. So you were well fed.
Hey Helen.
Yeah.
I noticed that your fence is not a normal straight fence. It's actually been created with angles on it, with gaps between the boards for airflow. Or what was the significance of building the fence?
It's much stronger. It's a much stronger windbreak, and it's got those different angles. It deflects the wind much more effectively, and so because it's a high-ish fence and extends right across my property, I wanted to make it stronger against any gales, because that's facing south, prevailing wind.
Mm. Yeah, I was looking at your shadow there, and I thought, okay, that's pretty interesting where you've placed that.
Yeah, and of course, I grow things up the fence as well, you know, so it gives me another growing place as well. So I've got vines and brambles and things like that. So, that's broad beans there, because the young vines and everything were small then, so I planted some broad beans.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
I was going to say about making your own compost. What tips would you have for people to make their own?
Well, I'm just going to have a drink of water because I'm croaking a bit. Well, I think good compost is the secret to growing good crops. And so I save a lot of materials before I have make a big batch of compost. So what have I got? I try to make compost the day I get fresh lawn clippings from my neighbour, because I don't have a lawn. So I have to get lawn clippings from somewhere else. Obviously, some untreated lawn clippings, no herbicides and things. And so the lawn clippings will help to generate some heat in the compost bin. I make my compost in big black bins, and they cook up quite nicely there. They get quite hot. And so the lawn clippings, freshly done that day. And then I will have saved bits of twigs and branches and things that I put through my chipper. I've got a chipper here. And so those have been saved in a bag in a dry place. And because they've got fresh leaves and things on them, enough moisture, they grow fungi in amongst all that. And so so I've got some bags of that. Sometimes I'll have some sawdust, untreated, of course. And then I'll try to get some animal manure. It might be horse or sheep or chickens or whatever. It doesn't really matter. But that helps to generate a bit of heat as well. What else do I have? I've got general garden waste, you know, spent leaves off the cabbages and all that kind of thing. And then I have wood ash. I've got a fireplace here. And sometimes I will incorporate some biochar, which I can talk about later as well. And then a bit of lime goes in there. So that I spread all those materials out on a tarp, on a big sheet, out in my working area in the backyard, and so a layer of this and a layer of that, and some, you know, dried leaves and or fresh leaves or whatever, and then it all gets sort of shoved into buckets, mixed up as you go, and into the compost bin, and that gradually fills up. Might have a bit of straw amongst it as well, and anything that I try to keep a balance between moist material and dry material, so that it's sometimes I need to add a bit of water to the compost as I'm going too, just so it's moist enough to help the activation, but not too wet. And then when the bin is completely full, then I'll top it up with some soil on top, and I'm hoping, I haven't really done the science on this, but I'm hoping that helps to absorb some of the methane that will invariably be produced during the composting process as the material is all heated. Yeah, now one thing I don't put in my compost as I'm making it is my kitchen waste. Because, well, for one thing, it could be inclined to attract vermin. But the other thing is I can add value by using the bokashi system, which is a fermentation system. And so I keep a bucket in my laundry, which is designed for the purpose of fermenting. It's a double bucket system, and so each time I add my vegetable waste to the bucket, I sprinkle an activator which has got mycelium in it, and so that grows fungi right through the bucket. When that bucket is full, then I take it out and I'll hollow out a bin of compost and incorporate the processed kitchen waste into it. I wait until the heating system, the heating of the compost has cooled down, so that I don't destroy the mycelium in the fermented food. So and the worms just love it. They come in and they get, because the fermented food looks pretty much the same as it did when it was. It hasn't started decomposing. It's been fermented, but once it's mixed with soil, then it breaks down and decomposes quite quickly. Yeah, and if you haven't, for people who don't have a composting system, they can just put it into a shallow trench, into their bucket, into a shallow trench in the garden. Mm. So it's I think it adds great value to my compost. Now I could tell you a little bit about biochar too.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah. Well, now biochar is the product of burning dry carbon material to in a process called pyrolysis. It is the burning takes place starved of oxygen. Now, I applied my some in. It's made commercially, and I can I don't make enough myself, but I do make some, and so this biochar is very porous, and it absorbs air, but it also absorbs nutrients, and holds on to those nutrients, and even the fungi and the various life forms can inhabit the biochar, and it's a fascinating topic if people want to look into it. Biochar New Zealand is a site that they look at, and I make little quantities of that myself in my wood burner. I get two cans, two empty, you know, food cans, and I flute one so that I can push it into the other. I put all sorts of things in there that I can use, since like walnut shells and hazelnut shells, and I dry my citrus peel, which is not easy to get use in your compost. So I dry the citrus peel and put that in there, spent seeds, because I'm a seed saver, and at the end of the season, you know, some of those seeds are surplus to requirements, and so they're dried in autumn. Biochar is something that is emerging as a great help when it comes to our CO2 emissions. And it's being used on farms and orchards and for agricultural purposes. And also it can be fed to livestock as well. It helps with their digestion and that sort of thing. There's even food grades of biochar. I think something that I'm very pleased to be able to use myself and promote, because I think, you know, as I said earlier, we've got to deal with this climate change business, and so it's one way we can help to do that. So there's forestry slash and all sorts of things that can be used.
I've not seen that over here, but then I live on a farm, so I can't have a garden as such. But I don't know if that's just a New Zealand project only, is it?
No, I don't think so. It's an ancient thing, really.
Is it? Okay, yeah. I've never heard of it. But,
It's just coming into its own again.
Mm. Did you have some little videos, Jeff?
Yeah, I've got a video.
That would be nice to check.
Well, now that's a film that I made called Our Money. And so that's me talking about the issue we have with interest-bearing debt and how that is at the heart of the requirement that our economy must be forever growing. The growth imperative is part of plays a big part in the ruination, really, of our environment, and it also has negative social and even economic impacts in the end. It's really at the heart of the boom and bust that we deal with, or try to deal with.
You want me to play it?
Yeah, no, I was thinking of the garden one, but I don't know quite what you've got there. But yeah, put a little bit on. We can have a look. Lovely scenery.
Can you hear it?
No.
No. That's really setting the scene there. It's the clock tower in my town. That's my house. Can't hear anything.
Funny we haven't got the sound, eh? But we can see you in action there. Yeah. You talk to all your plants when you're putting them in and have,
Yes. Yes. Oh, yes. Here's one of our compost bin. Mm. Mm.
Yeah, no, I don't know which I watch, but looking at all your vegetables, I mean, they looked just amazing. You know, they looked really healthy, no holes or insects or all sorts of things.
Yeah, here's the farmer's market.
At least when you go to the farmer's market, you know where it comes from and it's fresh.
That's right.
And that makes a big difference.
Yeah.
Because they're encouraging children and little children now to sort of grow little seeds and things, which is great.
Yeah.
I know you said a long time ago that you were, or in the early years, that you were selling your produce to help pay for your rates.
Oh, that's right. When we started our first garden, as a young couple, we bought the a piece of land and started a garden and we propped it for 2 years to pay for the rates while we were saving up to build the house. And something else I could tell you about is my children's book.
I was going to ask you about your children's book. Is it just the one that you've done, or have you done more than one?
Well, I didn't write it. My friends wrote it.
Okay.
I've got a copy of it here that I can show you if you like.
Oh, that would be lovely.
Can you see that? Yes.
Good for you, Helen Dew.
Yeah.
Nice little rhyme there.
It is. It is. Yeah. And so, my friends wrote that after they used to go out for a morning walk and they used to talk about all sorts of things in the world. And so they asked me if they could write a children's book, and I thought, about me, and I thought, well, for heaven's sake, what child is want to, you know, be interested in this old lady? But anyway, they came by the words and I thought they were very good, and so the text really encourages intergenerational conversation about issues, and it's proven very, very successful. So
Yeah, because I know there was a little video of you in a, you were sat somewhere reading to the children.
That's right, it was at the kindergarten.
Yes. Yeah, lovely.
Yeah, that was a lovely experience.
Yeah, and the children take it all in, don't they, when they're young?
Oh, they do. And they talk to their parents and that sort of thing too. So, yeah. Yes. So, yeah, what else is there? I mean, I think another issue that I haven't really done a lot with but is on my mind is democracy. I think, we need to encourage more participation and activity in the democratic process. If we want to improve matters, then we've got to take part in the whole process. And so people at all levels should be involved in making decisions in sort of what you might call participatory democracy.
Well, it's time for the people all to come together now, eh? There's a great awareness going on.
That's right. That's right. So I think, we're in a time of an evolutionary period we've had the agricultural revolution and the industrial revolution, and I think we're now entering a new phase of our way of being in this world, and we've got many, many challenges. And I'm quite concerned, really, for the coming generation. And I've got lots of children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And I'd like to think that we're giving them some tools to make life easier for themselves, as well as looking after the planet.
I suppose like one thing, if we get people that got gardens, I mean, you can do them in barrels, you can do them in flower pots and all, like kidney beans in a large flower pot, there's all sorts of things you can do now to have a small garden and try out all sorts of things. Yeah. And there's nothing nicer, is there, than picking something from the garden, something fresh. I mean,
somebody said to me, "Well, you can tell the difference, can't you, between your own food from the garden and the shops?" And I said, "Well, no, I can't, because I haven't tasted the stuff from those shops. I only know mine. I've always grown my own food." So,
this is why you look so well, and for your age, you're amazing how you keep going doing what you're doing. And it comes down to good nutrition.
Yeah, well, that's a big part of it. But also I think being part of the community, being very involved and contributing in whatever way I can, I think, it makes a huge difference. I'm becoming more frail as I get older, but I've got lots of people who come in and they'll bring me some cooked food and then I give them some produce from the garden and people just pop in for a chat so I'm very well supported here and I do appreciate it.
And that's all about community, isn't it? It's networking, caring and sharing.
Yeah, that's dead right.
And that that's the key, to all look out for each other, help each other, and like you say, swap, produce, that makes sense. Especially homemade things. I mean, you can't beat homemade.
No.
I went to get some apples in the local supermarket in Glastonbury, And anyway, I bought a packet and they were organic. And I thought, where did they come? And they came from New Zealand. They weren't from the local. And I was thinking, oh, it's crazy. Another story.
That's what happens when you get out of the UK, got out of Brexit, mate. You start buying product from the old Commonwealth.
I've just read a book, I've done a review copy of a book called Value Beyond Money. Now, that was a fascinating read. It was the history of the Bristol pound. And I don't know whether you've heard of that, Andrena. But,
no, I haven't.
It was a citywide local currency system. Vouchers, beautiful vouchers that were designed by the community and issued there. And so it encouraged people to shop locally and support their local shops in any way that they could. And they, you see, when we use ordinary money, then a lot of the wealth generated from our commercial activity leaves town. It goes to the big banks and out of the country. When we use a local currency, then all the wealth generated from that economic activity stays local, because local vouchers can only be spent in your own town.
Mm.
And so there's no leakage there. We're always going to need the global economy to work with, buying petrol and paying the phone bill and all those things. But there's a lot of things that we can use a local currency for, and it enables us too to start thinking a little more laterally about what can we do for ourselves that we're currently not doing. So it encourages innovation and local employment and cutting down the food miles with the way we meet our needs. So, when I think about the future, I think that we'll be doing some things quite differently to how we do things today. And as I said earlier, localization is a big part of it. Care for the earth, care for one another, and being much more what you might call conscious consumers.
Mm.
Doing with less, we don't need all this stuff.
Yes, it's like everything comes packed now, in the shops, like. Cucumbers are wrapped up so tight like a second skin, the poor things can't breathe, and then they're soft and don't last 5 minutes. The quality of some foods is but if you can grow your own. So any other tips or wisdom that you would like to share today?
I love to do preserving because I grow an abundance of fruit and vegetables, and so I've got a little dehydrator, so I dehydrate some fruit and some vegetables through the season, and do the old-fashioned canning and that sort of thing. So that's an important part. Of course, I do have a freezer. We live in modern times, and so a lot of things go in the freezer as well, but keeping those old skills alive, making the jam, and that sort of thing. Yeah, it's all part of, managing the resources in a really responsible way. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Was there, I thought there was another video. Is that it, Jeff? Was there of her going around the garden? Is that the only one you got?
Yeah.
All oh, right. Okay. So I must have seen it then, and yeah, because it
is
really
a tremendous website. I have to tell you, it's very good.
Yeah, we're very proud of it. Very proud of it.
Yeah.
And we're just in the process of inviting some new blood onto our board, because some of our board members, like me, have been around for a while, and so we need to make sure that this valuable website is going to be looked after and made available, because what we have here, I think, is a great resource for some of the challenges that we could be facing. So it's something that I think that when we first started, I used to run a bookshop and had all these books on the local economy and local money and things, healthy money, healthy planet, and interest and inflation-free money, and local money, what difference does it make, and all these different titles. And I used to take them out to conferences and things, and encourage people to become educated in these issues.
Now, New Zealand led the way with a guy called Jeffrey Morrell, who was the first member from the Social Credit Party to get elected to New Zealand government. The Social Credit had a system that's, as I read through this particular website, Living Economies, so a lot of the fundamentals come from social credit.
Yes, there are some distinct similarities there. And of course, we now have MMP as government system here. And if we'd had that back in the day, when Social Credit Party was really flourishing, that would have made a huge difference to things.
Right.
Yeah, but first past the post, it didn't work.
Mm.
So I noticed in here in Australia, particularly in Brisbane, we had LETs operating here.
Mm-hmm.
And it started up on the Sunshine Coast, up at Mullaney, and they set up the Mullaney Credit Union and LETs.
Yes.
And then they moved, they had it up there, and then they set it up in Brisbane's West End, which is quite a bohemian type. Bohemian, right? Yeah, so, but I don't think it's actually operating anymore. I think it died a natural death.
Yes, I think it has waned, and we've still got some systems in New Zealand, but I don't know whether anything's happening. It was doing quite well in some ways and supported by government too in Australia, but I think it's as you say, it's disappeared as far as I know. I haven't researched it.
Then we had the likes of Bartercard,
yes,
sort of system where they gave you social capital, and then they took a percentage in hard currency, and the rest was exchanged between members.
One of the issues with Bartercard and with other local currencies too is that you have to have somebody. See, with Bartercard, you had people who were paid to make sure that that there weren't sort of blockages in the system, with people whose goods or services were very much sought after, and they would accumulate all the credits, and so that had to be when I was in New York, I visited a supermarket there that was using a local currency too, and they had somebody whose job it was to look at the brokerage between those who were accumulating too much and those who needed to do more trade. So, it's not something that can be just left to run by itself.
Yeah, because I know on the Gold Coast, where it was founded, Bardico was founded on the Gold Coast. I'm quite sure it was a New Zealand bloke who was a pioneer of it in Australia from the Bardico. Anyway, there was a well-known Australian cricketer who got so many Bardico points that he invested into housing. So he put it into getting houses built. But then, of course, the tax man comes along and says you've got, you know, capital gains tax to pay in hard currency.
Yes, that's right.
So that business fell in a heap, yeah?
Yes, that's right.
And it's about this time of the year you'll start seeing ads in the local, it used to be in the local newspapers, and now it's obviously on the Facebook marketplace or something like that, where people sell their barter card points, you know, for 30 cents in the dollar, hard currency. So for every barter card dollar, they're selling it for 30 cents in order to get the hard currency to pay the tax bill.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Because, you know, I mean, some people have the mistaken idea that local currencies are a tax dodge, but they're not. If people are earning a local currency, they should be declaring it in the same way as they declare cash income and pay their due taxes. And it's just up to the people to front up and do that.
But yeah, a lot of people that I've spoken to are saying, well, first of all, you know, for every dollar that you you work, you know, you're paying the 30 cents tax on it, or, you know, whatever, 25 cents tax on it. And then as you start spending it, there's more tax taken out of your money. So your original dollars, by the time if you look at the net dollar, it's actually almost like, you know, 15 cents. The rest of it's gone out in different purchases, which has got its own tax on it. Well, you know, have a look at New Zealand with your fuel prices. You know, a lot of it's eaten up in tax on it.
That's right too, yeah. Well, that's something that, you know, we have to learn to live with, and
now in Australia and New Zealand, in the early days of Federation of Australia and also the New Zealand's purposes, getting hard currency to start a business was problematic, and of course, in New Zealand there, you mean had foreign exchange rules where you couldn't, you know, expedite money overseas unless you had a good cause for it. But people got together and set up cooperatives. So New Zealand and Australia was very strong in the cooperatives where, you know, suppliers, which would be farmers and transport companies and, say, the butter factory or the meatworks, were all cooperatives where everybody was benefiting all the way down the chain. But then, you know, once the money people got into it and said, look, we'll make more money for you if you sell your shares out of the cooperative and go into a public listed company, that was the doom for any local economy, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right, because it just bleeds, the local economy just hemorrhages. But but I think cooperatives, well run, well organized and well run, I think are going to be a big part of how we get through. You know, that'll be part of the future, I think. And there's a book called The Resilience Imperative, which talks about cooperatives, and it's I think a wonderful book that we could chart some of our way through turbulent waters. The Resilience Imperative. And that's something that I would like to set up a little reading group to have a look at that. So,
January last year, I was in the Southern Highlands of South Coast of New South Wales, which is around Abiga, which is the home of Bega Cheeses, which is a big major cooperative. And it was interesting to know that on the board of directors they had five farmers, and then they had two from the actual cheese factory, and then they had individual from a marketing company, and then the chairman of the board was a farmer who also worked in the cheese factory, and they were so level-headed. You know, you just talking to them, you know, they're really grounded, knew what their fiscal responsibility was, but also their community moral responsibility.
Yes, well, you see, cooperatives, you know, they're there for the benefit of one another, and not their shareholders. And, well, they are the shareholders. And so,
yeah.
And so they have a vested interest in making sure that things are squeaky clean and well run.
Hey, brilliant. Now, this Living Equities, Living Economies website, I'm going to put it back up there because just give that email address, because there's some really good stuff in there, particularly the story of usuries.
Yes.
And how the money works, yeah? And the relationship between the Jewish goldsmiths and... And of course, the story of King Henry VIII and the popes and all that stuff. This is really, this is a very good resource.
It's a gold mine. It really is.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
I'm pleased you like it.
Well, we want to share it. That's why we got you on the radio show tonight, you know, today. Play brilliant. Andrena, all yours.
Right. Is there any words of wisdom you'd like to leave us with today?
Well, words of wisdom. well, I suppose well, one thing I think just I stated it earlier. If we don't look after our environment, then we've got big problems because. The soil in particular, we need to look after our soil and not mine it as in commonly done in the mega agricultural systems. And so looking after our soil and an environment so that we can, you know, responsibly share all Earth's resources with all of the creatures that we're supposed to be sharing them with. And so, and then looking after one another, not exploiting one another, and I think those two things will go a long way to forming the basis of a healthy society and a thriving environment.
Well, you're an absolute gem. Oh, Helen, Carol's saying the same. You're a gem, as fresh as the morning dew. And it's been a pleasure to listen to you, and blessings. Yeah, we've so enjoyed listening to you before and watching your videos. And if anybody wants to see the other videos that we haven't got here, they can find you in Helen Dew on YouTube. But I just loved seeing your garden and, you know, handing out big cabbages and greens and, you know, such an inspiration. So keep on doing what you're doing. And thank you so much for being our guest today.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I really have appreciated this opportunity.
You're very welcome. And I hope you feel better soon.
Yeah, thank you. Good.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in this week. And same time, same place next week.